Hear ye, hear ye. I'm Dave Nelson, and on this fourth day of December 2014, I call to order this 32nd meeting of the Sci-Fi Geeks Club from GalacticNetcasts.com. Our guest geek this week is a podcaster, a blogger, a writer. He is the editor-in-chief of iTricks.com and WeirdThings.com. He's the co-host of Night Attack podcast with former Sci-Fi Geeks Club guest geek Brian Brushwood. Also, he co-hosts the podcast Weird Things and FSL Tonight, among other shows. He was one of the people behind the controversial book, The Diamond Club, and just re-released controversial. And then he just re-released his own book, Go Home Santa, You're Drunk. Welcome to the Sci-Fi Club, Justin Robert Young. Justin, how are you?
Three new stories on Go Home Santa, You're Drunk, too. Just so it's not just like, I'm just like, hey, it's Christmas again, idiots, buy my book. Like, hey, friends, there's three new stories if you would like it.
Well, I mean, and for people that have no idea it existed before, it's brand new to them.
Sure. Yeah, I mean, yeah, if you didn't buy it, then number one, you are an idiot, and I don't like you, and you shouldn't buy the book anyway. But if you choose to ignore my warnings, then you can go ahead and do it, and I think you'll enjoy it.
For those that have no idea what Go Home Santa, You're Drunk is, do you want to give a brief explanation of it?
Sure, yeah. I think Thanksgiving is probably my favorite holiday, but Christmas is my favorite season. It's so awesome that it just kind of has its own universe wrapped around it with all these kind of characters, and it's like this shared playground that we can all write in, and we have just this like sudden obsession with for a month annually, and then we immediately drop it like a bad habit. I wanted to write a book about Christmas stories, and specifically Santa, because he's a very interesting and weird character, and you know, the kind of stories that I like to write for that, I mean, are kind of like, you know, some of them are serious, some of them are funny, but I very much like to sort of explore different genres, and this was a good, you know, a chance for me to do that, and hopefully people have liked it, and hopefully soon we'll have the new audiobook version, which has a jazz score by Andrew Allen. He is working very diligently on that, and hopefully this weekend that'll be up. But you can go get the ebook on Amazon right now.
All right. Thank you again, Justin, for joining us. Our co-hosts, as always, Brad Ludwig, Anessa Moyens, and Matt. How are you guys doing?
Doing good.
Awesome.
Terrific.
All right. So this week's hypothetical question. You guys ready for this?
Yes.
And you all are required to answer this.
What?
Zombies are beating down your door, and you can only grab one thing to defend yourself, and it's got to be within eyeshot of you right now. What is it and why? Brad, do you want to go first?
Actually, there's an aluminum baseball bat right over there.
Sweet. That's the perfect tool. Perfect
and match. It's baby blue and pink, because it's...
It is. And just in case you think I'm... making that up. There it is.
Wow. You got anything you can put as spikes through that thing?
Well, actually, what we could do is because it's aluminum. Get a drill press, drill through it, and actually put bolts through it. And then, sure, once you got them tightened down, you sharpen the end of the bolts.
Perfect. All right. We'll see how everybody else fares here. Anessa, what do you got for a weapon against those zombies?
I have a feeling I'm going to be chunking a bunch of DVDs at them.
Well, you know, you get in the right angle, right? The right trajectory and the right power behind it.
You know, I saw a thing today. I already mentioned the Pluto TV thing, but there's a bunch of random shit out there. Sorry. One of the things was they were testing... the Shaun of the Dead thing where they're throwing the LPs, the records, at the zombies, and if that would actually work, and that totally failed. Well, I have scissors. There is a coat rack, and I have some lamps. I'm thinking maybe doing something with the coat rack and having the scissors handy just in case. So Yeah, I don't know.
I think you'll.
I also have like the kitchen, so I've got like a bunch of knives and kitchenware that I could use as well. But
all right.
Yeah, I'm thinking coat rack and scissors. So.
Well, you can only have one thing.
I know.
What's it gonna be?
I'll
what if
coat
she?
Rack.
What if she tapes the scissors to the
what
coat
if I,
rack?
Yeah,
though?
Like I can tape.
Boom. See.
To the coat rack.
Perfect.
There is tape in here too, so.
You make like a little makeshift bayonet.
See? Thinking. That's thinking right there. All right, I got a feeling that Matt's not going to do as well because he's inside a bedroom. Well, Brad was inside a bedroom too, more or less.
He's in the office.
No, he's in the office.
He's in the nerdatorium.
Matt, you're inside a bedroom. What is the one thing you're going to grab against those zombies to fight?
Do I have to fight or can I just drink a bunch of beer and give up? Because I have beer.
You can use a bottle.
You get them drunk. You get the zombies drunk.
That's a proven valid point. I can drink the beer, get drunk, break the bottle, and then stab them in the eye. Repeat.
What would be like the trademark of a drunk zombie? Like what would be behavioral patterns of a drunk zombie?
Hitbox in the straight line.
Yeah, they're gonna act completely sober.
Opposite of a drunk human.
Is that it? Like it could take its SATs and do really well?
Well, they already act like they're drunk, so I'd imagine it would have the opposite effect that it would on us.
They'll be able to do their
ABC. What kind of drunk are you people that you act like zombies? Like that's crazy. Like they're like running all over the place.
I'm just saying,
and
as
eating
far
people?
As like yeah. Some people when they get drunk, they like stagger.
Yeah, I guess staggering, sure, but like other than that, that might be the only thing. With the other zombie traits are like decomposition and murder.
Some people kill when they get drunk.
Well, that's and also very telling about you as a person.
Escalated quickly.
No,
I was a good person.
I clarified up front that Matt drinks on the podcast, so
that's what I'm good at.
Hey, listen, man. I'm not. I'm with you. And if anybody says that I turn into a zombie, then I'll bite them in the face until they turn into one of me.
See,
I have to say, since our guest likes Christmas, I'm drinking a beer called Sweet Baby Jesus.
Nice.
Yeah. who makes that, Matt?
Dewclaw Brewing. Somewhere Baltimore.
You get that through your exchange program, right?
I did. I got it last Friday. It came, and I managed to save one till today.
Sweet.
Woo-hoo.
Yeah, it tastes like a boozy Reese's Peanut Butter Cup.
Nice.
Yeah, it's probably the best beer I've ever had in my life.
There's really no... There's nothing in that sentence that's bad. Like a boozy Reese's Peanut Butter Cup. Like, that's a grand slam, my friend.
Yeah, if I have a couple too many of these, my shirt might come off. So,
been there, done that.
Happens to the best of us.
All right, yep. Justin, Robert Young, what's the one item in your room that you're going to grab to defend against the zombies?
So it's where I am right now, right?
Yeah.
Yep.
You know, I'm in my office here at the Go Game, which is like very whimsical and eclectic. So, I mean, I could grab a disco ball. There is a colored, a orange-colored little end table that I feel would be very good at crushing zombie skulls. there's a set of game show buzzers that are at my feet. So, yeah, dude. I feel like if I was going to settle on something, I'm not going to flatter myself and think that I can heft around this end table like I'm He-Man. I might have to go with this very, very handy label maker that I am right now holding in my hand. I feel like I would do that, and then I would write, Justin did this, and leave it on this zombie corpse so everybody would know that I'm awesome.
It's your calling card.
Yeah.
Perfect. All right. Well, correct answers all around. You guys all win.
Woohoo! Look at that.
So the first thing that we do on this show, on this little podcast, is do a little thing called Sci-Fi Bites, the stories that were big during the past week. And I'm just going to real quick run down the headlines, a few quick details, and jump in whenever you guys feel like you have something to say about it, all right?
All right.
Gotcha.
So since the last time we had a show, which was 2 weeks ago, the Star Wars The Force Awakens trailer was released. It'll hit theaters this time next year. Full trailer expected to drop before the Avengers Age of Ultron film in May. And all the awesome spoof versions of the trailer that have hit the web since the original hit. So first thoughts and feelings about the actual trailer, guys.
I don't care.
Clarify right now, Matt has no, he doesn't care.
I'm also a dick.
Well, yes, but, you know.
Well, does not caring make you a dick or just somebody who doesn't like Star Wars?
No, he's a dick.
No, I'm a dick, but I'm not a big Star Wars fan.
I mean, but you can be both, right? Because if you were like, hey, I don't care, and also I think you're dumb if you like Star Wars, then you're a dick, right?
I never said people are dumb if they like Star Wars.
Feel so bad about yourself. You're not.
Bad about myself at all. I think I'm pretty terrific.
I think so too. That's all I'm saying is you're a real swell guy, and I like your taste in beer, and I don't like you running yourself down like that.
Arena hug. The arena D-word. Hug before this is over.
We might.
I think you need to hug this out.
Justin, so, what do you think about the
trailer? How are we family friendly on this show?
Well. What do you
Dave
want?
Dave can edit.
Yeah, I'm right.
No, I no. Please, I am a podcaster. I will never force that on somebody willingly.
Dave can add the beep noise. It's fine.
No. I mean, it is extraordinarily exciting for me. You know, it's funny because I'm listening to How Star Wars Conquered the Universe, the new book just about the franchise in general, and I am at the point in which Star Wars was released in 1977 and what Lucas was on the record talking about at that time. And one of the things was that he was done directing Star Wars movies. And what he wanted to do was have all these other people that, specifically the contemporaries of his time, like Brian De Palma and Francis Ford Coppola and Steven Spielberg, to direct things in this universe, and then he wanted to direct the last one. And what I feel like we are about to have dawn before us is really that vision, where you have many people do many Star Wars stories, and we can kind of fully explore this universe that we've been kind of begging to explore for the past 40 plus years, or I guess coming up on 40 years. It's awesome, and I really liked the teaser. I thought it did a very good job of just sort of wetting our whistle, and it was all good JJ things as opposed to bad JJ things, of which there are a few. But you know, right down to the fact that, did you guys read this about the last sound you hear in the teaser?
No.
Yeah, is Luke Skywalker's lightsaber firing up that sound that was made in the in A New Hope in the first one in episode 4.
And of course Luke loses that lightsaber
in Empire
when he goes off with his rotting corpse hand you know, in Cloud City. And apparently I've tried my best to stay away from rumors, but There is one floating around that it is that artifact that helps set our plot in motion on some level. And if that's true, I'm really excited. And even if it's not, I'm excited that we're talking about minutiae and ridiculousness of Star Wars, and we have a hope that it's actually going to be good and not a boring lesson in silliness like the prequels.
You know, but that concept either sounds a little bit like, dude, where's my car? Or...
Hail Zoltan.
Or the search for Excalibur, you know, looking for a specific thing. It's all speculation at this point. I think my only criticism was the soccer ball robot. That just seemed kind of
Well,
weird.
I think there's an explanation for it. I mean, you can explain anything in a science fiction.
Or no, fantasy, sure.
Right?
Well, I mean, space fantasy more so than science fiction, which is what Star Wars has always been.
Yeah.
And gleefully so. It is about the characters and the story and the fun, wherein science fiction, not that it can't be fun or about the story, but there is great examples of science fiction that are far drier than space fantasy that we love for its dryness, you know, and we love for its more reality-based exploration of what our world could look like.
I really think that J.J. Abrams is going to do a better job with the Star Wars movie than he ever did with the Star Trek films. I think he tried to put too much Star Wars into a Star Trek, and I think he's more of a Star Wars person, which I think on record he's
gone on saying that, yeah.
Yeah.
So I think it's perfect.
But at the same time, I mean, he reinvigorated Star Trek, right? Like, yes. To the point where I'm kind of shocked we haven't seen a television show yet, and I would be shocked if Netflix or Amazon or any of those kind of new players that are spending top dollar for television didn't bring a new Star Trek series back. You know, it would be insane to me if we don't see that, and I don't think that happens without the JJ movies.
Yeah,
and being popular and being watchable.
Yeah, I think 2016 is probably the release date for the third film, which is the 50th anniversary, and I think at that time they're probably going to launch a TV series. At least that's what I've heard.
And they should, because it has lived far longer as a television series than it has a movie franchise, and it's like Doctor Who in that, I mean, in many ways it kind of is. There are so many parallels to the Star Trek franchise and Doctor Who, you know, with the America and the UK, in that it's just like a great avenue for genre science fiction stories.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Absolutely. Right.
Let's move on from one trailer to the next. Terminator Genesis released today. Have you guys seen it?
I have.
Yes.
Okay. So down the line, whoever's seen it, your thoughts on it?
I had to shift in my seat due to arousal.
And we should give the caveat that Matt is a huge Schwarzenegger fan.
Holy crap. I have actually changed my lock screen on my phone to Arnold Schwarzenegger, and it says, "Stop whining." I love Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Right, and there's no shame in that. There really
is. He's so good.
He's the best. I would marry you. I'll marry you, Arnold. I've covered this a few times on the show, and I was kind of hesitant, but I liked the trailer because it kind of answers some of the questions before that you need to ask them. Because most people that will see this movie have seen the original movie, and in the trailer when Sarah Connor, you know, says, "Hey, I know you're here to help me, but we already took care of that, but now we have a different problem." And then that's where they bring in Arnold. So I really hope it doesn't suck, but I'm at least kind of excited for it.
You know, there were a lot of plot details that leaked that certainly, I think, out of context seemed a little weird to people that you sort of saw played out in the trailer and I guess confirmed. My only criticism, and it is minor, so I will say it before I lavish praise upon it, is that both of the Cameron Terminators were really great because they were worn and gritty. You know, the future that we saw felt like just a burnt out husk of Los Angeles, in a very real way. And in the same way that JJ seems to be taking very seriously bringing back the worn universe of Star Wars, I would have liked to have seen things a little less polished in the Terminator movie. But at the same time, if it does right what is great and unique about the Terminator franchise, which was completely missing in the McGee movie that came out a few years ago, time travel, alternate timelines, whether or not you can or cannot change the future, which was such an integral part of those stories, and now it seems like we're coming back to it. Like, now we're changing the rules. Where there was first uncertainty, now we again have uncertainty in how this stuff works, and I think it can be really rad.
So, now, going back to what you said about how it looks too polished, answer honestly if you think that someone who is not familiar with the original Terminator movies or movies from that genre, if they would see a gritty movie now and not say, well, that looks like garbage, because everything is polished and everything is big and shiny and everything explodes. So I think to captivate the new audience, it has to be shiny.
I mean, that's certainly the studio's point of view, and I you know, they're the one putting money behind it, and that's, I think, the idea. But I would counter that with, I think Star Wars Episode 7 will look grittier than Terminator Salvation. I will suspect that it will make more money. Now, that's Star Wars versus Terminator, and obviously that is its own thing. But I don't think that people will balk at. I mean, people more balked at the prequel Star Wars because they looked too polished compared to what the original Star Wars looked like. So I think, you know, you can make an argument both ways. At the end of the day, though, the aesthetic of the film matters less, in my opinion, than whether or not the script is good, the characters are engaging, and the acting is up to par.
Yes.
So what did you guys think of seeing the different actors playing those characters that you're familiar with?
With the exception of Jai Courtney, the actress that's playing Sarah Connor, who is from Game of Thrones.
Khaleesi.
Yes. Looks like... I mean, if you squint your eyes and you... It kind of looks like a very young Linda Hamilton. And the guy that they have playing the part of the T-1000... looks a little bit like Robert Patrick, and I think they made some deliberate casting choices to kind of soften that, you know, yes, we are doing this movie 20, you know, almost, oh my God, almost 30 years after the fact. Mm-hmm. but they're trying to soften.
Well, no, Terminator 3 came out...
Well, I'm 2000? Just thinking of the original... I'm thinking original Terminator, okay. Which was
like
84, whatever.
Yeah.
It kind of feels like they're trying to. I mean, they're going all the way back to the first Terminator film, and it looks like they're moving us up to which would be like Terminator 3 almost. From what we see in the trailer, we almost touch those three films. It looks like. So it looks like they are kind of going all the way back, paying homage to those films, but then also kind of turning things on its ear so that. It's interesting, and it would make people ask a lot of questions and have a desire to show up and put their butt in a seat and pay the ticket price.
Can I ask you guys about one part about the trailer, though? You know when, like, everyone's, like, gathering around where, like, they hoist Jai Courtney up, and it's like, hey, let's all gather around and look at Jai Courtney's dong. I guess I always imagined that process to be a little bit more private.
Kyle Dong!
I know. And he doesn't seem all that weird about it. He's like, I will go back. And, like, I guess his dong plays a pretty important part of the franchise, considering he has to inseminate Sarah Connor.
He knows that he sports a killer pillar.
He does. He looked, I don't know. I guess I thought of it more as like a doctor's appointment where it was like, you know, maybe a physician or something, and they had a curtain, and they sent
turn
you back
your,
in time.
Turn your head and cough. It'll be fine.
Yeah.
Never heard Killer Peeler before. That's awesome. That's perfect.
I'm just thinking that knowing who John Connor is and how he can give a speech, I bet you he gave the best damn speech he's ever given in his life, and Kyle's like, hell yeah, I'm taking my clothes off right now. Let's do this thing. Bam!
Exactly. I really just hope that public nudity is a key plot point in Terminator Genesis. I think it's just, you know, if only you can show your hog to 40 people, you'll be able to save my mom. There's only fate is what you make.
All right, hey, let's segue from Jai Courtney being naked to Jai Courtney in the Suicide Squad movie. How about that?
And for the record, Jai Courtney gave one of my most hated performances ever in the last Die Hard movie. I thought he was terrible, and that movie took years off my life.
He's what's his face's kid in that movie?
Yeah, and he's terrible in it. Terrible movies can make good actors seem terrible. See episodes 1 through 3. But I'm going to have a hard time. I mean, now he's going to be Hollywood's It Boy, and I'm going to have a hard time. I got a little ways to go before I'm on the Jai Courtney fanboy bandwagon.
Did you see Jack Reacher?
I didn't, no.
And he is in that, and that will definitely cleanse your palate. He's not in it much, but when he shows up, he gives a performance and a level of presence that you're like, this guy's he's serious.
Yeah.
It's got Tom Cruise in it, but it's actually a good film.
I dig Cruise. Cruise is good. No, I mean, I haven't seen that movie, not because I don't like it or was not interested in it. Like, I just never haven't got around. But I'm glad that's a good recommendation.
No, it's a good film, and Jai Courtney's performance in that film is he comes across as a serious serious hench dude, and he comes across very scary. So,
well, let's talk about the Suicide Squad. And Brad, you're the resident comic book guy on the cast here on the whatever this is called.
This podcast thing.
Will Smith as Deadshot, Tom Hardy as Rick Flagg, Margot Robbie as Harley Quinn. First time a Harley Quinn character is going to be in a live-action film, right? Or live-action anything?
Well, you can kind of make the argument that Harley Quinn showed up in Arrow in season 2.
Really?
You hear her voice, and you see the back of a blonde woman's head. And it's a bunch of people that are actually in the squad, the Suicide Squad in Arrow, and you're led to believe that that is Harley Quinn.
Hey, speaking of the, I want to touch on this real quick. The Arrow, the Flash crossover this week.
Yeah.
They actually uttered the word Batman in the Flash. Just want to put that out there. That's it. That's all I want to say.
I think they did that because that's the only way they're going to get to a Gotham crossover or a Batman crossover.
That's the only thing.
Yeah.
So your thoughts on this cast?
Yeah, Suicide Squad, I know them from the early 80s. The cast was, at that time, was like Bronze Tiger, who we've seen in Arrow, a really badass martial artist. You've got Captain Boomerang. I mean, you've got a lot of weird Deadshot. I'm trying to think of some other, the Enchantress, a couple other characters, and a lot of the characters that you're seeing put in this film, with the only exclusion here being Harley Quinn, who wasn't actually created until the 90s. I think they've got an interesting cast. I think it's very interesting. And it's not that big of a deal, because, I mean, we make changes in characters all the time, but Deadshot in the Arrow and in the comics happens to be a white dude. And that's, you know, he's got like a porn mustache, too. With the mask off, he looks like a creepy...
He certainly looks like a white person that's less famous than Will Smith.
Yeah.
So, you know, they're trying to sell tickets here, kids. Yeah. Race knows no ticket value.
And at the end of the day, you want to have the best actor or actress portraying the parts, and it shouldn't really matter.
We're over that, right? I guess we're not. We're over the, like, oh, black people can't do white people things in comics, right? That seems so 90s. It's like bitching about Michael Clark Duncan as Kingpin.
Yeah, and he was a great cast for that. He made a solid Kingpin. I don't care what anybody says.
Certainly the low on the list of problems with that movie was that Michael Clark Duncan was a black Kingpin.
Yeah.
There's a podcast that I listen to called Geek Something, Geek History Lesson, or no, what's it called? Hang on. I'm drawing a blank here. It's really good. Geek History Lesson, and they were talking about... Well, what's his name? From the Marvel Universe. He was head of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Nick Fury.
Yeah, and they were talking about that exact same thing, how why couldn't they just put an African-American actor in the role of Nick Fury and not make a big deal out of it, not, you know, jump through hoops explaining why he's black?
I think the way they got around that really, one, we're more enlightened now, but two, this was a separate universe that Nick Fury and Brian Hitch, who was the artist for the Ultimates, which is the version of the Avengers in this other universe, which actually they are taking a lot of Ultimate stuff is what you see in the MCU movies.
But isn't the prime Marvel universe in the comics, isn't he now the Samuel Jackson lookalike Nick Fury now? That's what I heard.
You know, and I haven't read Marvel comics for
I believe
for like 5 years.
That's more of the law of comics, where if it's selling somewhere, then they are going to change it to make it like the thing that is popular.
Yeah.
And with Nick Fury, you know, I mean, Samuel Jackson, like Will Smith, really, like, is almost not post-racial. He's Sam Jackson, you know, and like Will Smith is Will Smith, and that's why we are excited about that, because the idea that, you know, Nick Fury isn't going to be, oh, he's a black guy. It's like, oh, he's intense, and he has that voice, and he can get really angry and dress somebody down because he's really mad about something. Like, these are all things that we would like to see in Nick Fury, and Sam Jackson inherently brings to so many roles. Can I just ask one question? Because, and I'm at the risk of getting my nerd ghetto card revoked. What the hell, Suicide Squad? Can somebody please explain to me the plot of Suicide Squad?
Suicide Squad was actually put together by Amanda Waller, and it's a kind of a second chance for villains in the DC universe that have been nabbed by the federal government, and basically they are given missions where you may or may not live, but if you do this mission, we will shorten your time, we will give you freedom, whatever. There is an exchange for it, but the mission that they're doing, they're probably going to die.
So it's like Dirty Dozen. Dirty Dozen.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's great. I mean, that's a great concept. And they certainly went all in for the cast. I think my larger problem with it, if I do have one, is that I really hope that Superman versus Batman is good, because I totally agree with James Gunn in that, you know, a big shared universe franchise needs to be built off at least one good, fascinating movie. And I don't think Man of Steel was that. No. I liked Man of Steel walking out of the theater, but I didn't really want to spend any more time in that universe.
Yeah.
I hope Batman versus Superman is.
The DC universe is probably doing a better job with the shared universe than the movies are trying to do. I think because they had Arrow, and now they've got The Flash. No, it's going to be on CBS. It sounds like that Supergirl TV show is going to be in the same universe as those two shows.
Yeah.
So they're gradually building on that universe. So it seems like they're doing a better job than the actual movie universe.
The common thread there is the MCU. When they did Iron Man, it was kind of a, not necessarily a lark, but they didn't have anything to lose, and they took chances, and it really paid off. And Marvel was very cautious with how they didn't overshadow the movie stuff. They let it build, and the shared universe came about naturally. And I don't think at the beginning, it was partially intended. But as it became more successful and they were able to pull in the other properties, they slowly built this house. And what I feel that Warner Brothers is doing is they're like, and they're just going to put together a house. They're just going to drop a house on everybody, and everybody's just going to have to, you know, suck it in.
It's a prefab house is what you're talking about.
Well, I think that in order to create a shared universe, they did something smart in that they've got Joss Whedon or somebody that's incredibly talented to oversee the broad picture and make sure that everything else kind of fits within the style. And they slowly built that infrastructure to make that work well. And it really kind of feels that with the movies, they're not doing that. You look at the TV shows, brilliantly, they started with Arrow. It was very popular. And then they decided to do to bring in Barry Allen. And that episode did pretty well. And then they decided to do a pilot. The pilot was picked up. And now that's been doing phenomenally well. And I'm pretty sure that the anticipation and excitement of the Firestorm character, they might actually be able to build more properties in TV. But again, they're slowly building that.
And it's coming from popularity. It comes from the fact that people see The Flash and they say, I want more Flash.
Yeah.
You know, we saw Iron Man and Clark Gregg's character reveals that he's from S.H.I.E.L.D. And we're like, oh, wow, that's cool.
Yeah.
I'd like to see an Avengers movie with this Iron Man, and then we get all these other people building up to those.
Exactly.
You know, we watch Star Wars, and we're like, well, I mean, I assume the Empire isn't done. They might, in fact, strike back. I'm curious to see how and when that happens.
Yeah, exactly.
And especially when with Batman and Superman, I just worry, and Suicide Squad too, where it's like, I feel like these ideas are living far more clearly as press releases than they are going to final products, in that, hey, look, we've just listed the top, between Batman and Superman and Suicide Squad, we have now listed 20 DC characters and properties
yes.
that will rank among the top, I mean, if not the top 20 that DC owns, right?
Yeah. Yep.
So if this sucks, these two movies suck, theoretically, you have burnt your top 20 characters.
Yeah. No, and that's what's so dangerous about what they're doing. And, you know, I hope that they've got the infrastructure. I hope that Warner has really taken a close look at what Marvel has done to build their shared universe and maybe not necessarily copy it, but take away some of the good things from it that they could, you know, build a coherent, prosperous, and successful operation. But if they haven't, yeah, they're setting a lot of things on fire, and for no good reason.
If it doesn't work, let's bring in the elongated man and see how he does.
Ralph Dibny rules. I don't care what anybody says.
Man, you're joking, but like the way that they just add and they keep leaking this, like, you know, like, oh well, Suicide Squad and Doomsday is gonna be in it, and so is Lex Luthor, and so is your mom. Yes, all of our moms are going to
yes.
be in the one movie.
All right.
Exactly.
One more sci-fi bite. Congratulations to Andy Weir, winner of the Sci-Fi Book of the Year for Goodreads. He beat out Andy Weir, former guest on this very podcast, beating out another former guest of this very podcast, Hugh Howey, for his book Sand. Also, he beat out John Scalzi. And a couple other authors that I'm... Oh, Terry Pratchett. I know that person.
Yep.
Sounds familiar.
And that's for The Martian, right?
Yes, The Martian. Yep.
Yeah, fun story. We were doing a live stream for Weird Things about the Orion rocket launch today. And we had a young woman who hosts a show called Space Exploration, or Exploration Space, I can't remember. And we were just talking about space and Mars and the private space boom and how rad everything is. And it devolved into Brian just berating her for not reading The Martian. So that book leaves an impression, and it is in my queue right after Star Wars. So I'm very excited to read it. Even though I met Andy Weir at a book signing, and he was nice enough for me to take a picture with me flipping off Brian because Brian was so obsessed with the book.
Yeah, actually, when Brian was the one that turned us onto it. When he came on, he's like, "Oh, dude, you need to read The Martian."
Yeah, he was very excited about that book when he was on.
And we all went, "Oh, God, we better read The Martian," and we did. And then we actually got Andy on the show, and
we got Andy before all of us were done with that book. So we're like, "Oh, we got
no, 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 no." I was done with the book.
Okay. Right.
Yeah. I was driving from Michigan to Wisconsin, so he had plenty of time to read. But no, I had heard an interview with Andy Weir on Science Fridays, a podcast that I listen to from PRI. And
Public Radio does podcasts now? That's crazy.
Well, it was NPR, and then it was like NPRI or PRI.
No, I know. I'm just being an ass because everybody loves them.
and so, you know, like I would, when it wasn't freezing outside, I'd listen to podcasts while mowing the lawn and whatnot. And that's how I heard about Andy Weir. And then, but I had totally forgotten about it. And then a friend of mine was like, oh man, like this book is really good. And I'm like, sweet, adding it to the list. And then it was around that time that we ended up having Brian on the show. And he's like, you have to read book. So
Brian Hawks the Martian. He proselytizes about the Martian the way Christians proselytize the Bible. Like that dude.
But absolutely.
He believes in the power and will not rest until your soul is too saved.
The Martian is a much more entertaining read than the Bible is. Just
shots fired. Shots fired. Do you hear that?
I'm saying,
suck off.
I'm pissing off Christians everywhere, but much better book.
Hey, the main character is not unlike Jesus in that he does, you know, he lives, he rises.
He has super sweet long hair. Don't spoil anything because I want to read it.
No, it's really
he's like Jesus in that he's got great abs.
Yes.
Great abs, great hair. You know, you just
he's the whole package.
He's Matt Damon after all. Come on.
Yeah, no. He's got great abs, great hair, and a real don't hassle me bro attitude.
Matt Damon.
All right, let's jump into the discussion stories.
I feel like we did an entire podcast already. This is all
yeah, all right, good night.
Yeah, actually, guys, I'm sorry. I do have to peace out in like 10 minutes.
Okay.
So I'm probably good for one discussion story.
Okay. Oh, mine sucks so bad too.
Okay. Justin, do you have anything in particular that you want us to talk about first, or something that you wanted to bring up?
Oh, no. Yeah, I'm here. I'm here for you. You guys roll.
Okay. Oh man, Brad, I didn't realize that you had the Terminator Genesis story.
No, and that's, you know what? That cuts down a story that we need to cover. Boom. All right. Max. Okay.
Let's jump into Matt. Matt, you got some kind of board game you want to talk about.
Five of them, actually, Dave.
Some kind of board game. Oh. Some of these are... One of these is on my Amazon wish list. Another one we played last weekend. It's not just some kind of board game.
I've heard of this game, or I've heard of one of these. Oh, Pandemic. That's the one that you were playing.
Yep. Pandemic is pretty cool.
Okay.
Got that Pandemic. Boom.
So entertaining to have a Pandemic.
Wow.
You know, it kills a Saturday afternoon.
It does.
All right, Matt.
So that's a chain-based card game, right? I feel like I've played this one before.
Pandemic?
Is that a card game?
Kind of. It's a board game.
Or is it like Ticket to Ride?
Not quite.
It's sort of, because you basically are working to stem the tide of four major diseases on Earth. And you have to go around and you need to find the cure for each of these diseases and stop outbreaks throughout the world. And it's a pretty fast-paced game. Absolutely.
Yeah, so you have a map and you're moving across the map, but you're working together rather than in Ticket to Ride where you're trying to screw each other over, getting from point A to point B.
Yeah.
So that's kind of nice, but...
So wait, hold on. How fast does it take to play?
I think it took us about 20 minutes.
Oh, yeah, wow. It was like 20 to 30 minutes. It wasn't very long.
That's
good. It would probably be a little longer. It would probably be shorter if you played, you know, like the extremely hard, because there's different levels levels of difficulty that you can play. And it's a really hard game to beat. Because it was our first time playing, so we played easy mode. But next time, I would definitely give hard mode a try, or whatever the other difficulty settings are.
That's really good to hear, because me and Ash have been hosting these board game nights, and I've kind of become obsessed with like the perfect way to like stagger your board games, because like there really is a science to like you want something super easy up front that's like engaging and fast. Like no one wants to lock into like an hour long board game as soon as they sit down, right?
Yes.
Yeah, you have to be prepared for a long board game. If that's what you want to play, you need to know that's what you're getting into. But if you're like, well, I don't really want to commit hour and a half.
Like, you know, you gotta prime the pump. You know,
you gotta
get everybody all loosened up. You know, you gotta. I feel like it's like a downward slide to me, like organizing an orgy or something.
But like, right. Well, no, because we made the mistake. This was Thanksgiving evening. We were playing board games, and we made the mistake of getting started on a game that is very slow paced, and it took. We played, I think, for what, 3 hours?
It was like two and a half, three hours.
It's like 2.5, 3 hours because half the people playing hadn't played it before, so there was a bit of a learning curve.
And my butt was numb by the end of it. It's like, hey, I'm not even.
And, you know, 2 o'clock in the morning trying to figure out who murdered who. It's like Clue on a Train. It's called Mystery Express.
Yeah.
That's a game that you need to know how long it's going to take. You have to be committed to that time.
It takes as long as an actual train trip from Milwaukee to San Francisco.
Pretty much, because, you know, it was kind of funny because it'd be like, okay, you're traveling from point A to point B. It's going to take 4 hours. You need to do stuff to kill this time. And I feel like we went on one of those trips playing the game.
All right. Hey, Matt, what else is on this list as far as games?
That got derailed so quickly.
Sorry.
There's a game. No, that's fine. There's a game called Galaxy Trucker. Apparently,
that's on my list that I want to play.
You build a ship, and then you have to travel around and pick stuff up and collect cargo and dodge asteroids and fend off pirates.
Boom.
I want to play that.
It sounded pretty
played
fun.
It's on my list.
The ones further down start to sound a little more ridiculous. This game called Eclipse. Each player chooses a different alien race with varying abilities. Players must capture territories, extract resources, and build a fleet. And then you can research different abilities. It sounds to me like the board game version of like a real-time strategy video game.
Yeah.
It's apparently boasts its high replayability because of this. Then there's a game called Twilight Imperium, which sounds like Risk in space.
Yeah, so, it's a long game.
Yeah, it sounds god-awful to me. And then the last game is Android, and it is a complex narrative-based noir detective sci-fi game. It takes place in a vaguely Blade Runner-esque future and revolves around different detectives solving a crime.
They all sound pretty cool.
Android sounds kind of fun, but the problem is I have the attention span of, like, a newt.
Yes,
so I'd, like, set the game up and then try to read the instructions and just get bored and give up.
Yeah, I think you would like Pandemic, honestly, because
I really like the game. I like the iOS game Plague Inc., which sounds exactly the same, where you have to like evolve this disease and try and kill everybody.
I think we lost Justin.
We did.
I heard him get in his car. Oh well.
Oh, there he's back.
Oh, he's back.
Yeah, sorry guys.
It's all good.
All right,
that's it for me. So.
Okay, cool.
So, yeah.
Some gift ideas, holidays coming up. Gift ideas, there you go. Some great games to give the game lover on your list. Ho, ho, ho.
Oh, hell yeah.
Well, there's Hanukkah, too, I suppose.
Yeah, I said holidays, didn't say Christmas.
Yeah, no, Kwanzaa.
But you tossed in the ho, 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 so.
Well, you know, that side of Christmas is very non-religious specific. I think anybody's cool with Santa Claus.
I actually disagree with you. I feel like it's very. I feel like people like Santa Claus as a character, but I think he's pretty well locked up on the Christmas front.
Okay. All right. Yeah. Oh well, let's talk.
That's kind of his gimmick. It's like his one thing that he does is show up on Christmas.
Well, I mean, not every. You don't have to be a Christian to celebrate Christmas. I mean, it's a very non-religious holiday now. It's not. Not specifically.
It's still very much a religious holiday.
I mean, it's kind of got Christ in the name, right? Like, you know, even though it's not like all about Jesus being born so much, like it definitely is. It's like it's not called the Jewishness, you know, or you know, African harvestness or whatever Kwanzaa is about.
But, I mean, there's a lot of people that aren't Christian that still celebrate Christmas.
That's because everyone likes
it's
getting
stuff. It's for the
stuff.
Gifts.
Yeah, no, that's a big part of it. Yeah, I agree.
I mean, do they? Is that a, I mean, I know mixed families do. Like, that's one side Christian, one
yeah,
side Jewish. Like,
we'll
I think
celebrate a little bit of both.
I don't know. I mean, I might be wrong, man. Like, I have no idea. I just don't know if there's like a Jewish family that's like, yeah, man, we rock Kwanzaa hard, and then afterward we totally bang out a good Christmas.
Why not go all the way? You know, go all out, celebrate them all. You know, what the hell?
Like, I don't know why you wouldn't. Like that. Yeah. I mean, doesn't make it. And also, it's like, I guess. I mean, listen, I love Christmas, and I'm not. I mean, I was raised Methodist. I was raised celebrating Christmas, but I'm not exactly a churchgoer now. So maybe so. I mean, maybe I am the answer to my query. I don't, you know.
All right. Well, let's talk about something that's happening on Christmas Day, which is the
my birthday. Wait, what?
Yes.
You too.
Anesmus. It's Anesmus. It's Christmas, and it's the Doctor Who Christmas special. And I know that both Anessa is a big fan of the show. Well, I think we're all big fans of Doctor Who.
Except for Matt.
Yeah, I was going to say, if you guys are going to talk about Doctor Who, I'm going to go sleep.
Okay, all right, good night.
Good night, Matt.
God damn it.
No, I know Justin is a big fan. Anessa is not a fan of the Clara-centric stories that were on this last season. So you may be upset about the story, but there's word going around that Jenna Coleman not leaving Doctor Who just yet. Supposedly she was supposed to leave on the Christmas episode, or that was supposed to be her exit, and she kind of had a change of heart, according to The Mirror, at least. And The Mirror, as you know, or you maybe you don't know, is more like a kind of a tabloid paper, yeah.
A printer of lies.
Filthy,
well, I hope this
filthy
is a lie.
Lies.
What'd you say, Anessa?
Said, well, then I hope this is a lie.
Yeah.
It's a way for it to be a surprise. Like, surprise, she's leaving after all.
Yeah. What do you guys think? What's the chances that she's actually gonna stay or go on the Christmas special?
She's
at this point.
60-40, she does crack.
He's just like, hey, listen, man. I mean, it would be reasonable. I feel like, you know, she just went through a really horrific thing with, like, her fiance or love of her life, like, you know, becoming a robot, dying, and, you know, she was like, dude, this is really rough, and I'm gonna just try out some crack real quick and, like, just... You know, like see if it fits.
See how it goes, trial run.
Yeah, I wouldn't blame her.
Crack
know?
Does turn all your bad feelings into good feelings.
You know, Justin, I thought you were totally talking about her justification for leaving the doctor. I didn't think that you were actually talking about
crack. Oh, no.
I guess it could be that, too.
Pretty extreme measures there.
Well, listen, man. Like, I'm not her dad. She can do what she wants. I would say, I the only thing that makes me think she's not leaving is that they haven't usually made those a surprise. They've usually announced it and then announced the successor before they have the send off. So I was fully on board with the whole she's leaving thing, but. I don't know. Maybe they want to surprise us this time. I'm on the opposite side of you on the Clara stuff. I thought this was the first time that I gave a rat's patoot about the companion storylines in this season compared to the previous, you know, everything since the first Amy season.
Yeah, well, because my thing with Clara is...
No, Clara.
I'm American. It's Clara.
Yeah. Suck it, Britos.
Yeah.
I love country Britain, but...
Anessa's leaving bodies tonight. First it's the Bible, now it's the entirety of the King's English. Eat it.
Yeah, no, like...
Boom.
My thing is, we ended up with the new Doctor, and I wish that he had a little more opportunity to shine as the new Doctor. And I just feel like the focus on her and her storyline kind of took away from Capaldi. Or Capaldi, however people say it, but
I totally see where you're coming from. The only thing that I would say is that, and as became very clear as the season went on, this was a fairly dramatic tonal reboot for the show. You know, a lot of how they wrote the Doctor, both for Tennant and Matt Smith, which was fairly similar, had to kind of be just done a different way. The Doctor was a very different person, and if you don't have a through line to kind of keep constant through everything, I think it would have been even more jarring than it was. And so although I hear you, because that was part of my frustration with some of the episodes that I think was kind of creatively rewarding by the end, was that, like, hey, just more of this dude. I want to know more of his story, and yet we focus so much on Clara and Pinkman, or is he just Pink? No, Jesse Pinkman's from Breaking Bad.
Yeah, so it's Breaking Bad.
it's just Pink. So.
But yeah, I mean, so you get that, and I thought at times that was ham-fisted, like the stupid Forest episode. But by and large, it was at least it served the story, and it was never far away from the central conflict between the Doctor and Clara, which I enjoyed.
Yeah, and the other issue that I had with Clara is they kind of turned her into, like, some of the other companions in just the way that how they treat their significant others and how they're always keeping secrets or lying or treating them like crap. And she was never really fully honest with her boyfriend until he was about to be hit by a bus. And she's like, I'm going to tell you the truth. And then he's like, bam.
Well, you know, so, the only...
It gets old after a while. I think that's why I like Donna so much, was she wasn't having any of it.
Well, the you know, my only counter to that is you look at the entirety of her storyline, it was her basically, she didn't trust the Doctor, this new Doctor, and she didn't like the fact that he wasn't always straight with her. But then by the end, the two of them looked right each other in the eye and lied. So her storyline at this point was her kind of becoming the Doctor and living a life where she understood why he does the things that he does, even though when she started out, she was criticizing him for doing those things.
But and she was still lying from the beginning.
Well, she's always kind of been a bit of a, you know...
But she never lied to the Doctor, really. And she did at the end.
Well, she still lied to the Doctor by saying she wasn't seeing him, or she
knew
what was going on, and so...
But I was saying that, what I'm saying is that she didn't know if he was a good man, yet she kind of walked down the road where she wasn't really a good person either.
Yeah.
That's a good point. Very good point.
You know, she looked at the Doctor and said, yep, Danny and I are great, everything's fine, not that, oh, well, fuck, he's dead, sorry. She totally left that out, and that's kind of a big thing. And I think that was ultimately the end of her story, and that they're going to continue on with it. Whatever, it's got to be a new thing. But
so, how long is that one going to last? The, like, hey, my boyfriend's dead, but I'm like saying he's alive, unless they go in like a weird like Weekend at Bernie's kind of route of it. But
well, I really think that, you know, this Christmas episode is going to be like, hey, you need to come with me because something bad's happening. And, oh, by the way, I didn't find Gallifrey. And, oh, by the way, yeah, Danny gave his life up for somebody else.
Yeah, they both
and maybe St. Nick's going to end up
yes,
bringing that, back.
Yes, well, that's what I was saying. Danny. They both lied to each other. And at the beginning of that, she wouldn't have done that to him. He would have done that to her. Mm-hmm. And through the course of the storyline, especially when we get to the 2D story, where she actually kind of enjoys being the Doctor, and she ends up telling white lies to all these people that she's supposed to save, when she before was giving him, you know, all sorts of hell for doing it to people, she understood why, and that was her journey. And then at the end, she got to be so good at it, she could look the Doctor right in the eye and lie to him to make him feel better about things.
Wow, that's quite the analysis, Brad. I didn't even think of it lot of that.
Yeah, no, I do think that Clara got a good character arc, and that's something that's been sorely missing since that first Amy Pond season, where we kind of almost too neatly wrapped up what I thought was a fascinating.
Oh, the crack in the wall.
Oh, he dropped out.
Justin's gone. Okay.
Oh, oops.
Oh well. Cool. That was a great discussion. You guys want to add anything more before we move on?
No.
Well, the BBC is saying nothing about it. They're basically saying they're not going to comment on speculation. You'll just have to find out when the Christmas episode airs on Christmas. So we'll see. December 25th. Anessa, what do you got for?
Well, Spokane is going to be hosting the 2015 World Science Fiction Convention. So I just thought that was kind of...
The World Science Fiction Convention.
The World Science Fiction Convention, not just, you know, regionally specific science fiction convention.
Now, is this more like science fiction, like literature science fiction? Is that what the type of science fiction you're talking about?
Well, the article says about 5,000 science fiction fans are expected to beam down to Spokane next summer for the sci-fi convention, which honestly seems like a really small number for it being a world thing. Yeah. But it's the 73rd annual WorldCon, and it's also going to be where the annual Hugo Award winners are announced among the prestigious honors for sci-fi and fantasy writing. And it sounds like it's going to be a little bit of everything. There's going to be panels, presentations, music events, sessions with artists and authors, and a no-holds-barred masquerade ball. Woo-hoo!
Oh, geez. Bring a tarp.
So, yeah, they describe it as the Super Bowl of sci-fi fandom. But it sounds like it's not specifically just for science fiction writers. It's for artists as well. And I'm sure there's going to be, like, comic book artists and whatnot. Just probably a lot like every other con that I've been to.
But it sounds like this one's more specifically aimed at or centered around science fiction writing. Because they're going to have Hugo Award winners there, that's definitely...
They're going to have writing. They're going to have artists. Again, they're going to have musicians. Initially, when it started back in 1939, it was a cult attraction for readers of pulp sci-fi. But today, it's a different kind of convention, drawing writers, artists, fans, editors, publishers, academics, and dealers who have an interest in sci-fi. So I think initially its main focus was for science fiction writing, but I think it's evolved enough to where it has branched out and what attracts people to that particular convention. So,
well, 5,000 people, they have to up their game a little bit. Is it 5,000 you said?
It says 5,000. I'm wondering if maybe it's supposed to be 50?
What is like San Diego get? Or Dragon Con get?
A lot more than 5,000.
Yeah.
Yeah, because, like, I'm trying to remember which con it was that I went to. I think it was Dallas Comic Con. And they were expecting, I think, about 10,000 people. And they ended up getting around 25 to 30,000 people. And, I mean, that's not as big of a con as I would think WorldCon would be if it's been around since 1939. So.
Hey, Anessa, real quick, going to just jump in real quick, and Justin's got to run. So thanks, Justin, for joining us.
Thank you guys so, so much. This has been a real blast.
Where can people find you, and what do you want to? Where do you want them to go?
Justin R. Young on Twitter. That's pretty much where everything is.
And nice. Go. Santa, You're Drunk is re-released for the holiday.
Yeah. GoHomeSanta.com, or you can find it on Amazon.
All right. Thanks a lot, Justin. Appreciate you coming on.
Thanks, guys. Have a good night.
Thank you.
All right.
Good night.
Bye.
Good night. Bye. All right. Sorry, Anessa. That's fine. Continue.
But yeah, the con is going to be August 19th through the 23rd, and it's a big deal in sci-fi. But I've not really been familiar with it, so... And it's apparently had a stop in San Antonio at some point. I missed out on that. So, yeah. Huh. If people are going to be in the area, Spokane, Washington area in August, I say go check it out. Let us know how it is.
You got a whole year to get your cosplay costume ready to go.
Yeah, or at the very least, get your camera ready to take pictures of the cosplayers. So.
There you go. All right. We just had a con here. Didn't even know about it until it was over with. I was kind of mad. But next year is the year for conventions for Dave.
Sweet.
All right, is that all? Is that all I got? All you got?
I could ramble on more, but yeah, that's pretty much it.
Is there more to the story? We could talk about it some more.
Let's see. What else is there? There's going to be about 500 volunteers working at WorldCon to keep it running smoothly. But yeah, that's pretty much it.
All right.
It sounds like it would be kind of a cool thing to check out.
So Google WorldCon if you're interested, and it's next August in Spokane, right?
Yep. Because it's WorldCon, it's not like at the same spot, so.
Oh, I see. I get it. Has it gone to other countries? If it's WorldCon, has it been international yet? You know.
I imagine so. Maybe. All I know is like the past three WorldCons took place in Chicago, San Antonio, actually yes, and London. So it has been overseas.
So it's kind of like the Olympics. It goes from city to city.
It goes from city to city, but for science fiction and fantasy nerds.
And it's not every 4 years, it's every year.
Every year, since 1939.
Wow, that's a long time. Holy crap.
Yeah.
All right, there you go. And that's the show, pretty much, gang. Any final thoughts on any of the stories? You want to tie the knot on any of these that you want to mention before we go? No?
One thing before we do go is Justin's a part of Night Attack, and their album is looking to their third album is looking to come out on CD Baby here in just the next couple of weeks.
Is it available now, like on iTunes and other like?
No.
Okay.
No, it's not going to be released until it's supposed to be released on the 16th of December, and they're doing it through. CD Baby. So,
all right. I highly recommend you guys check out Night Attack, but if you are sensitive when it comes to the profanity, then I would not listen, or I would just go into it knowing that there's a lot of swearing on that show. His other podcast that Justin's on, Weird Things, is really good. I highly recommend that. So there's if you don't want the swearing, check out Weird Things. They talk a lot about space things. SpaceX and other space-related topics.
Sweet.
All right. That's going to do it for this episode of the Sci-Fi Geeks Club. Thanks, everybody, for joining us. Thanks to Justin Robert Young for being our guest this week. You can subscribe to us. We are on iTunes, Stitcher, and TuneIn. Just do a search on those platforms or go to galacticnetcasts.com and click on subscribe. You can follow us on the Facebook, on the Twitter, on the Google Plus, and hey, feedback. We welcome that as well. 805-328-3966 is our voicemail number. Leave a message, and we'll air it on the show, or give us feedback via email, galacticnetcasts@gmail.com.
What are you going to get angry feedback about the Bible.
Oh, bring it on. We welcome it. 805-328-3966, galacticnetcasts@gmail.com. Hey, you know what? Any kind of feedback, negative or positive, if you want to talk about it, we'll discuss it with you via feedback. How about that?
I will say that I have tried to read the Bible and didn't get all the way through it. Got all the way through The Martian, so that's where I make my decision as far as which one is more entertaining.
Yeah. And The Martian's a lot shorter, too.
It's a lot shorter. I did get through a few books, Old Testament I started from the beginning.
You know what? The Old Testament, like the early Old Testament books, and then like Revelations are the most interesting part of the whole Bible.
And they are. But yeah, I think partway through, I just never got around to reading anymore. But there's some messed up stuff that goes on in the Old Testament. I'm like, yeah. Man.
A lot of murders and like...
And incest.
Yeah.
And
yeah. No yeah. Holds barred. It's Bible after dark.
Yeah. And the whole Clara thing. It's how I say things. So no offense against British people. I love your country. But...
You're going to hear from Daryl Johnson.
Daryl's going to be like, oh, I can't believe it.
What's his name? Help me out. The filmmaker we had on, what's his name? Sorry. Shoot.
Rob Smith.
Yeah, Rob Smith. Thank you. Thank you very much.
I don't think I met him. I think I was gone.
All right. That's going to do it. Thanks for joining us. And until next time, I call this meeting of the Sci-Fi Geeks Club adjourned. Good night, everybody.
Good night.
Good night. Bye, Dad.